Tantor Audio presents The Soprano Sorceress by L.E. Modesitt, Jr. Narrated by Amy Landon. Part 1. Leetrom. 1. West of the Sand Pass, Defalk. A dozen musicians sit on stools under the oblong white silk awning held in place by four sturdy poles, each pole anchored by heavy cords to a pair of stakes. The silk flutters slightly in the almost still air that carries the scent of dust and horses. The brown and red mountains that loom in the east above the pass entrance waver in the summer heat, and sweat drips down the faces of the musicians. All wear faded blue cotton tunics and trousers with boots of a matching blue leather. Occasionally one blots a forehead or cheek, but not one of the musicians speaks. Dark sweat stains mark the tunics of the heavier men. The three horn players exchange glances, not quite those of worry, then look toward the two men standing in the midday sun beyond the silk awning. The bigger man, wearing leathers and a hand-and-a-half blade in a scabbard worn across his shoulders, puts a hand on the saddle of his warhorse. A good 50 paces to the east wait a squad of mounted troopers wearing the purple of Defalk. Their black sabers are sheathed in scabbards at their waists. Half carry black horn bows and quivers, and half bear long spear lances with identical leaf-shaped steel blades.
"You're sure these walls will stand against even the dark monks?"
drawls the bulky, broad-faced man. His hooded eyes give his face a sleepy-looking cast.
"What I raise will be standing when you and I are long gone, Lord Barjum,"
affirms the resonant baritone voice of the slender and balding man in blue silks.
"That'll be a long time, Brill," laughs the Lord of Defalk. "You look the same as when I was Jim Bob's age. They'll stand that long or longer. Aye, and they should for all the silver I'm paying. It's far less than bringing in masons from Nordway. Not that much, not in these times."
Barjum pauses, as if waiting for a response, then finally continues,
"Too bad you couldn't bring us rain. Need that worse than the fort, except we need both, with the dark ones on the move."
He looks down at the shorter lord.
"I still don't see why you can't bring rain. It's not as though you've avoided dark song, we both know that."
"That's too dark, and I've explained why before,"
Brill answers patiently.
"You have an answer for everything,"
points out Barjum.
"That's why you're a sorcerer."
"No," responds Brill. "That's why I've survived as a sorcerer."
"Cold iron is more sure."
"That is true, Lord,"
says Brill, his tone light, not quite mocking.
"Unless you consider the dark monks."
"Some day."
Barjum shakes his head.
"I'll leave you to your task, Master Sorcerer. I'll be back to inspect your work later and, of course, pay you."
"Of course, Lord."
Brill bows deeply. Lord Barjum snorts and turns, swinging up onto his mount. As he rides toward his troopers, they straighten in their identical purpled leather saddles. Once the troopers pass the outcropping of dark stone on the south side of the valley, they turn due west, back toward Mencha, away from the sand pass that leads to Ebra. When the sound of hoofs on the paved highway echoes back uphill, Lord Brill lets a smile cross his lips. He glances toward the representative piles of stone and brick, the dry powdered mortar and the tubs of water, then steps under the silk sunshade and wipes his forehead. After he takes a long sip from the goblet on the portable table, his brown-flecked green eyes drop to the two-part drawing of the walled fortification fastened with leather thongs to the drafting board. The right-hand side of the drawing illustrates the foundation outline. The left-hand side a frontal view, as if seen from a tall oak, though Brill stands in the middle of a depression between the hills, empty except for the sorcerer and his players, and the heaps of stone on the south side. Beside the drawing are the spells, with the proper accents marked. The softness in Brill's eyes vanishes as he faces the musicians.
"The ground-sorting tune," he orders. "Run through it once."
He lifts his right hand and began the count, marking the time deftly.
"One, two."
With his nod, the musicians begin the sonorous tones, the brass horns low and urgent, the woodwinds panther-like, the strings whispering like shifting sands.
"No, Jigal, you must emphasize the downbeats more, especially the first."
Brill's hands stop the players, and his eyes flash. Not one of the musicians looks up, although one of the horn players scowls, his face averted from Brill. In the last part of the string section, a black-haired youth takes a clean gray cloth and blots his forehead quickly before replacing the cloth and repositioning his bow.
"Again," Brill demands.
As the musicians play, the ground beyond the bricks and mortar and water appears to shiver. The sorcerer nods.
"Good. Take a moment. Some water, wipe your foreheads."
Without looking at the 7 men and 3 women, he turns the drafting board so that he can direct the musicians, see the drawing and the spell, and the ground where the fort is to rise. Brill waits. The silk awning above ripples in the hint of a breeze, and the only sounds are soft and muted as the musicians drink and blot foreheads, necks, and fingers.
"Places,"
the sorcerer finally announces. The 10 players reseat themselves on their stools and take up their instruments. The last to lift an instrument is the black-haired young man in the back with the viola.
"Now, 1, 2.
Brill's resonant baritone wraps around the notes the musicians play.
"Cleave the ground, even, straight, and true, more cleanly than the diggers do. Scour the stones both smooth and flat."
The sorcerer sings, the musicians play, and a silver haze settles onto the hilltop where the soil shifts and the ground parts. The air stills completely, and the awning hangs limply in the heat, and even the scents of parched grass, dust, and horses seem to vanish. At the end of the song spell, Brill's hand slashes for silence, and the song haze vanishes. The silk awning flutters.
"You have a few moments,"
the sorcerer says. He takes the spotless white cloth from his pocket and wipes, then blots his steaming forehead, before lifting his iron-tipped staff and walking out into the full sun and toward the sets of trenches that had appeared on the hilltop after the song haze lifted. The sorcerer walks the trenches, and the staff taps the lines of exposed stone, stone remelted into the foundation pattern. Under the awning, the players stretch and stand, except for the woodwind player whose braided white and red hair betray her age far more than her creamy skin. Her cold eyes follow the sorcerer until he begins his return, when she looks down and takes a quick sip from her water bottle, then moistens her lips and her reed.
"The foundation is solid."
Brill blots his forehead a last time before folding the cloth and slipping it back into his pocket.
"Places."
With a soft shuffling, the musicians square themselves on their stools and lift their instruments in response to the sorcerer's hands. Their notes follow his tempo and his voice.
"Replicate the bricks and stones. Place them in their proper zones. Set the blocks and set them square. Set them to their pattern there."
The hilltop shimmers, as do the bricks and stones, and the heaps of mortar and the tubs of water tremble. Dull crackings whisper through the haze from the south side of the valley. When the silver haze lifts, Brill turns toward the structure that looms there, newly built. Stone-based brick walls rise the height of 4 tall men and stretch across the floor of the valley, almost joining the 2 hills. The dark stone outcropping to the southwest of the fort has almost vanished, 2/3 of its bulk sliced away.
Behold Lord Barjum's new stronghold against the dark monks of Ebra.
Lord Brill frowns, then whirls toward the players.
Someone was humming.
Brill's eyes scan the musicians.
Someone was humming, and look. Look at that gate wall.
His hand jabs westward. The left-hand side of the arched gate is crooked, out of true. The sorcerer reaches for his goblet and drains it, setting it on the small table with a thud.
Jarrow!
A thin youth runs from the wagon and the tethered horses to the west.
Yes, Lord Brill?
More water.
Brill grasps the staff and carries it as he walks across the trampled, sun-parched grasses and onto the paved road that resumes a dozen yards from the magically built fort's gate, beyond the bricked and dry moat. He keeps tapping the iron-tipped staff as he continues through the open brick archway, across the brick-paved courtyard, to the low brick-walled building that stands roofless in the afternoon sun. The staff raps against the walls, against stone and paving stone, against mortar and brick, for a long time, before he slowly walks back under the white silk awning that scarcely flutters in the still air.
The gate, thank the powers of song, is the only flaw.
His now dark-circled eyes sweep the musicians.
I should starve you all.
His eyes lighten.
Refresh yourselves, and then we will use the symmetry spell to repair the gate.
Brill limps, ever so slightly, to the drafting board, where he studies the spell and begins to murmur to himself. After a time, he takes a mark stick from the wallet on his belt and begins to write out a revised similarity spell below the others. Under the back section of the awning, the black-haired young man glances nervously toward the white-haired violino player in the front row, but the older man sips from his water bottle without acknowledging the scrutiny. With a last slash across the yellow paper on the drafting board, the sorcerer turns and straightens.
Places.
Brill takes a deep breath.
Similarity one, please. No humming, fast tempo.
His hands begin marking the time, and his sharp nod cues the musicians as the music rises.
Set true and straight, both sides of the gate.
This time the spell is short, and the song haze lingers only over the gate for what seems to be instants. The sorcerer slashes the music to a halt, staggers, before taking another deep breath, then a gulp of water from the goblet on the small table. Only then does he turn and walk back toward the gate. A dozen paces are sufficient to confirm his handiwork. The gate is straight, with no sign of deformity. With a quick nod to himself, he studies the gate for a time. His steps are stronger as he heads back through the hot, still afternoon to the shade of the awning. The musicians wait, silently.
Culane, you hummed again.
No, sir, no,
protests the white-haired man who clutches the violino.
I did not.
I will not have lying, and I will not have carelessness jeopardize me or those around you. Once is an accident. Twice is arrogant disregard.
Brill's eyes turn hard as jade as his mouth opens in song, as Culane backs away out from under the lightly fluttering silk awning and into pitiless afternoon sun.
Once a man is not always a man, lower than dust, softer than.
As the song haze rolls across Culane, shrouding him, tears well up in the eyes of the black-haired young man. The woodwind player's eyes remain cold and dry. 2. Anna looked into the mirror, trying to ignore the fine lines running from her eyes. You look like a raccoon. She used the tissue to blot her eyes. If only. With a deep breath, she tried to push the offending viola out of her mind. She had given the final examination for her last course, Introduction to Music, and the sheets were even graded. The Scantron helped a lot, even if she hated multiple guest tests. But there was no way she was about to grade 80 essay tests for an intro course. The viola? Don't think about the viola, she told herself. But it was Irenia's viola, an instrument tied irrevocably to her daughter. She took a deep breath and blotted her eyes again. Why had she accepted the dean's invitation to sing at the founder's dinner for major donors? Because it was extra money, only $50, but the ATM had said her balance was down to 200, and it was almost 2 weeks until the first. Her eyes flicked to the viola. Funerals. Who would have thought a simple funeral would have been so expensive? Outside of the small policy paid for years ago by her father, there hadn't been any insurance, and that just hadn't been enough. Avery, the self-styled perfect husband and tenor, had always paid for things like insurance, and while she'd taken out insurance on herself for the children, she hadn't thought about insurance on them, even if she'd been able to afford it. A quick glance at the clock told her that she had less than a half hour to pull herself together. She blew her nose, then looked at the empty glass on the dresser. No, one drink was all she could take. First, makeup to repair the ravages of grief and age. The two seemed to go together. The crooked and cheap Queen Anne stool that Sandy had repaired with metal straps before they'd broken off the relationship cracked, as it always did when she sat down. Everything Sandy did had been a little rough, but he'd been there when Avery hadn't. For a while. Was the cracking of the straps louder? Did that mean she was heavier? Makeup. Concentrate on one thing at a time. When she finished, Anna studied her face. She used a touch more mascara, then stood. What would she wear? As she rummaged in the closet, she began the vocalizes. Once it had taken only a few minutes to warm up, but these days it took longer, a lot longer. Holly lolly polly pop. Good, her throat was clear, her cords resilient. The green formal gown was clean, and she hadn't worn it where the president had seen it. After hanging it from the top of the folding closet door, she rummaged through the plastic bags she'd never unpacked or put in the drawers until she found the new long-line bra. She hated any kind of bra, but she couldn't wear the gown without it. Then came the slip, tight, almost too tight. She sucked in her stomach as she zipped it, then twisted it around, checking in the full-length mirror. Of course, it wasn't straight, and when she tried to straighten it, the bra twisted. Finally, with both bra and formal slip in place, she took a deep breath. Holly lolly polly pop. She could breathe, and it wasn't as though she'd be doing Mimi or Butterfly. It was just 5 songs for the university's big donors, the founder's dinner. She took down the gown and slipped it out of the plastic before beginning the struggle. These days, everything was a struggle, especially zipping a formal gown without help. Her eyes strayed toward the picture on the Queen Anne dresser. The four of them, one of the few with just the children and her. Most of the old family pictures had Avery in them. He'd been insisting that he was Antonio or Tony 30 years, but Anna had known him when he'd been Avery Marshall, long before he'd become Antonio Marsali. The great Antonio Marsali, king of the Compromarios, who'd never paid a cent toward any of the children's education, except for Irenia. They all looked so young. Irenia, Mario, and Elisabetta, even Anna herself, standing in front of the lilacs at the lake house. Now it was Avery's vacation home. How could she have been so stupid? Shoes. The green ones were in the corner, she thought, and they were. Her eyes went back to the picture, to the blonde-haired young man. Mario always joked that he was Northern Italian, or a WASP Italian, probably just to irritate his father. Marsali had been Avery's great-grandmother's maiden name, and she was the only Italian in the family. But Avery, the great Antonio, had insisted that an Italian name was a must for an opera singer, especially a high baritone. Then he'd become a tenor. After Mario had left to go back to Houston, the condo had seemed so empty, but he called, like a dutiful son, every few days. Anna blew her nose and looked away from the picture. Think about singing. Think about singing. Jewelry? Something ornate enough not to get lost, but simple. The silver necklace didn't look right. The gold link necklace looked good, but where had she put the earrings? They were where she'd left them, next to the telephone. She squared her shoulders. I can do this. She lifted the lipstick and touched up her upper lip. I can do this. Especially since the president was the only supporter she had left, now that Deesher had become chair of the music department. She could sing for the major donor dinner, and Deesher would sit by the president and say sickly sweet things like, Anna's so good with young voices, or, she does very well without a doctorate, as if she'd had any choice. She went to the window. Cloudy, but it wasn't raining, not yet. She picked up the green leather purse and hurried downstairs. Her raincoat, not exactly fashion-coordinated with the gown, was folded across the banister. After slipping it on, she glanced at the clock. 5:40. Checked for her keys, then locked the door and stepped out under the townhouse's pseudo-Georgian portico. The cramped townhouse condo was definitely not what she would have ideally chosen, but aging junior music faculty members lived where the bargains were, in this case, the colonial mansions. A roll of thunder was followed by a spattering of rain on the sidewalk, and a gust of wind that whipped the long skirt of the green formal around her calves. Her hand went to her hair. The umbrella was in the car. The line of rain struck the far side of the parking lot and gusted across toward her. Damn! She was going to be late, or wet, or both, and she was being paid to look good as well as sing. Damn! I'd just like to run away. Anywhere. Anywhere. She repeated grimly. Anywhere. As she reached for her key to let herself back into the condo, the world swirled around her. 3. Mencha de Falk. The black-haired young man bounces in the saddle a last time as he reins up the horse in front of the thick-walled cottage. The dark-oiled wooden shutters are closed against the midday heat, and not even the chickens are out in the hot, still air. Dust lies heavy on the planks of the small porch, shaded by the overhanging eaves, and the oiled oak door is shut as tightly as the windows. After wiping the muddy sweat created by road dust off his forehead, he struggles down from the horse and ties the mare at the heavy stone hitching post at the end of the porch under the single oak in the yard. Then he eases the viola case from the oversized saddlebag.
Well, Daffod, where'd ye be getting a horse? Asks the slender brunette from the half-open door.
Her hair is pulled back and bound high enough on the back of her neck to lift it clear of her neck. She wears a sleeveless homespun brown shirt that reaches mid-thigh over loose gray trousers that stop at mid-calf. Her feet are bare.
It was Dawes.
Daffod looks to the half-open door.
He give it to ye. A fine gift that'd be.
He be dead, Jenny. Lord Brill killed him.
Daffod takes the two steps onto the porch, then stops several paces short of her, the canvas and wooden case in his right hand. The brunette steps back toward the door.
What be ye here for?
You owe me, Jenny, Daffod says. You be owing me more than you can ever pay. How many times have I played for you just the way you wanted, to send or summon folks all the way to Nordway or Eliok?
I've been more than nice to you, Daffod.
Daffod flushes, then adds,
I
and I've been nice to you, not charging you for the music.
If Lord Brill be after you...
He's not after me.
Daffod waits. Then why are you here? The young man wipes his forehead.
You could invite me in where it's cooler. You've no company.
His eyes traverse the dust on the porch planks, unmarked except by his boots. Jenny tightens her lips and looks toward the empty lane, then jerks her head toward the door.
Jenny, seeing as it's me, no one would be saying anything.
Come in, then, seeing as there's no stopping you.
She stands back from the door. Daffod crosses the porch and steps inside, closing the heavy door with his left hand. The main room is empty, but a faint scent of onions wafts from the kitchen area to the left rear of the cottage. While the cottage is cooler than the late morning heat outside, Daffod wipes his forehead with the back of his left hand, his right still clutching the old brown canvas viola case.
Well, fine talking, Daffod. What do you want?
The brunette looks to the closed heavy door and then at the mirror on the cottage wall.
I can't bring your da back from the dark shadows. Lord Brill himself couldn't do that. I could send you to Farway. That's as far as I can do.
That won't bring back da.
Nothing will bring back your da. Not even Meringuey could do that. I'm a rote travel sorceress, good enough to hold a house, but not more. You told me that yourself. Remember that?
Daffod pulls his lips together, then he speaks.
He hummed. Just a few notes. Just a little. That was all, and only once. Not twice, like Brill said.
That'd be strong. Accusing Lord Brill of lying, he'd not like that.
Like it or not, he lied. Da hummed a little. He's hummed for years. Everyone knows that. But he doesn't hum tunes, and it's never upset patterning before.
Just a few notes in front of the land's strongest sorcerer.
Jenny shivers, pursing her narrow lips.
He turned him into dust, just dust, and the wind blew him away.
All I can do is send you somewhere,
she repeats.
Can you bring someone here?
Aye, if they want to come. But who wants to come to Dry Defolk?
Daffod smiles.
Bring me a sorceress, one out of the mists. Make her blonde and strong enough to turn Lord Brill into red dust himself.
Jenny shivers again.
Out of the mists? A sorceress? She'd have to want to come. And what one of them would want to leave the mists? Why would they help the likes of you?
Try it, please.
I don't know.
You try it, or I'll keep you from sending anyone anywhere.
Daffod's voice turns cold.
You do, and Lord Brill will be a-chasing you.
Jenny backs away.
And you don't be threatening me, Daffod. You're not the only friend I've got.
You aren't the only one I've got, either.
Daffod shrugs.
Mayhap, but it's my cottage where you've come.
She crosses her arms and waits. Daffod sighs and waits. Finally, he speaks.
You're the best I know, and I need the best.
Ha! You tell all the girls that, and that's just when you want something.
She walked over the bare open space of the room to the stone hearth, then turns and recrosses her arms.
What you want is trouble.
I need a strong sorceress.
What am I? Failed bread?
Daffod's lips tighten, and his breath hisses out through his nose. After a moment, he asks,
Do you want to take on Brill?
Am I looking as daft as a heat-struck fowl?
The young man shrugs.
Oh, Daffod, you've always been trouble.
Daffod sets the viola case on the battered waist-high square table set against the wall that separates the kitchen from the main room. He opens the case carefully and extracts the polished viola, then the bow.
I need a spell for the mists, points out Jenny.
I have one.
He gently sets the viola on the table beside the case and fumbles in his wallet before extracting a scrap of paper covered with smeared mark stick. He reads the words slowly.
Bring us a singer, truly strong, from the mists beyond our song. Her voice like fire, hair like gold, her words filled with flame and bold.
Jenny holds up her hand.
This spell's pretty chancy, Daffod. You could get a blonde-haired lizard that sings.
Let me read it all the way through.
The brunette nods. Daffod glances down and keeps reading, his voice deliberate as he pronounces each word. When he finishes, he looks at Jenny and asks,
Well?
It might work. Just you make sure you play it all the way through. Those first lines are chancy.
She takes a deep breath and looks at the mirror on the cottage wall.
But you get her out of here quick-like. I'll be telling Lord Brill you tricked me. You understand that, don't you? I'd have to be telling him that.
Daffod nods.
Recite it again. I need to get the words in my head. Then you'll be playing your tune. I'll be needing to listen a few times.
She shakes her head.
A sorceress out of the mists. Why?
4. Anna completed an uncertain step, swaying for an instant. The outdoor light of Ames had been replaced with something gloomier and hotter. She stood in the middle of a room, smaller than the cramped living room in the condo. The walls were a dirty white plaster that was uneven and rough, and there was no ceiling, just open rafters. The faint light that seeped around ill-fitting shutters on the room's two windows was the only source of illumination. Where was she? How had she gotten there? Had she fainted? Her hand twinged, and the door key was somehow burning in her hand. Anna slipped the key into the green leather purse, then squeezed her fingers together, pressing her thumbnail into her palm, stopping before the pressure became pain. White spots flickered in front of her eyes, and she forced herself to take a deep breath, then another.
What had happened?
You did it! You did it!
Exclaimed a male voice, interrupting her self-inquiries.
A travel sorceress I am. Give me a good spell and a decent tune, and I will bring someone from anywhere, answered a woman. You'd better hope she's what you want.
Wondering what the young man wanted, and fearing that she did know, Anna slowly turned from the hearth. On her left were the two shuttered windows. On her right, a wall containing only a single wood-framed mirror, and near the far end, a closed wooden door. In the middle of the room stood two figures. The man, black-haired and somehow both angular and round-faced, was barely out of youth. He held what looked to be a viola and a heavily arched shed bow, and wore faded blue trousers and an armless and collarless shirt fastened with oblong wooden buttons. The woman was several years older, square-faced, in short trousers and a baggy armless blouse. Behind them was another wall, with an opening into another room.
"She is beautiful," the man said, as if Anna were not even present.
Anna hated being referred to in the third person. It reminded her of all too many auditions, especially the year she'd been in New York.
A sorceress has to appear beautiful, Daffod. You do not know what she really looks like.
Anna glanced down. She still wore the raincoat over the gown, and she was getting hot in the small, stuffy room. After a moment, she unfastened the buttons and the trench coat's belt, and stuffed the ends of the belt into the coat's pockets. Then her eyes went back to the woman.
I'm Anna. Who are you?
Her words sounded firm. Totally inane, but firm.
I am Jenny, lady.
The brunette offered a slight bow. Anna's eyes went to the man.
Daffod.
His voice was defensive, and he didn't bow.
Where was she?
They spoke English, or she understood what they spoke, but it sounded like English.
Could you tell me where I might be?
Another totally inane question. She was in a peasant cottage, or totally out of her mind. Had she been hit by a tornado like Dorothy? And was she lying somewhere, hallucinating? Or worse, had Sandy been right about parallel universes or worlds? She'd always believed that the world was the world. Another thought flicked through her mind, a thought that seemed to move so slowly. Time travel?
Why, you were in Jenny's cottage, answered Daffod sardonically.
That much I surmised, snapped Anna, reacting to the teenaged student tone she'd heard all too many times in her life already, particularly from ungrateful students. But where is Jenny's cottage? And when? The two locals exchanged glances. Daffod walked to the square table on the wall and slipped first the viola, then the bow, into a canvas case. He did not close the case. Anna sighed, then stripped off the raincoat and folded it over her arm. The heat was making her feel faint, and the last thing she wanted was to collapse in front of total strangers in this unknown place. Could you please tell me where we are?
We are in Mencia, and it is on the eastern marches of Defalk, said Daffod,
as if the entire world knew the obvious. That helped a lot, reflected Anna, before answering, I'm sorry, but I've never heard of Mencia or Defalk, and I don't know the name of your world.
It is the world, the earth, answered the brunette. Some of the sorcerers call it Erde.
Erde, mused Anna. Germanic, but the two didn't look especially Teutonic.
Except for the worlds of the mist, added Daffod, it be the only world.
The only world? Anna felt flushed. Might I have something to drink? It's been a long trip. Again, the two exchanged glances, as if Anna had said something profoundly stupid, and she wanted to scream. That would have made matters worse, it always did. Then Jenny bowed slightly, turned, and walked through the opening in the wall to what might have been a kitchen, although all Anna saw was what seemed to be a brick stove and a table with a bench on one side. Her legs felt stiff, and Anna looked for a place to sit. There were two short benches and a higher stool. Daffod kept looking at her as if she were not quite real, the way her new students did after she'd done a recital, as if they couldn't believe that she could sing. Really sing. Bother it. Anna stepped away from the unused hearth toward the stool. She set her purse on the dusty plank floor and quickly folded the raincoat over the rough wooden stool, hoping that the trench coat would shield the gown from any splinters. As she sat, her nose twitched from the dust in the hot room, and she rubbed it gently, almost afraid to sneeze. Jenny returned across the dusty plank floors, a brown earthenware mug in her hands. She extended the handleless mug to Anna. Here, lady. Thank you. Anna stared at the water in the mug. It looked clean.
I spell my water clean, offered Jenny. Most folks can't, you know, and they won't pay to get it done.
Spelling water clean? What sort of place was this Erde? Like a medieval pigsty? Thank you. Anna sipped the lukewarm water, then drank the mug down to the bottom. She'd been thirstier than she'd realized. The two continued to study her intently, as if looking for some sort of sign. Why did you bring me here? Anna reached down and lifted the green leather purse into her lap, rummaging through it for a handkerchief. She used the rumpled cloth to blot her damp forehead gently. The room was hot, hotter than the colonial, and she had the feeling that it was even hotter outside. She looked down at the purse. The leather around the metal clasps was browned, as if it had been scorched or burned. She didn't recall that, but she'd grabbed the purse in a hurry. Daffod looked down at the dusty planks.
Daffod needs a sorceress from out of the mists, Jenny finally volunteered.
A sorceress?
You can't be serious. A sorceress? They thought Anna was a sorceress? What sort of a nut house was this?
You have to be a sorceress. Jenny couldn't have brought you here if you weren't,
stammered the youth with the short and ragged black hair. Why do you need a sorceress? Anna had trouble believing she was behaving so rationally. Or was it irrational to talk sensibly in a lunatic situation? Daffod and Jenny exchanged glances.
Well? Lord Brill. He turned my Da into red dust because he hummed during a wall raising. He said Da ruined the spell, and that was why the gate was crooked. But Da never hummed in tunes. It was just an excuse.
Anna moistened her lips. The more she heard, the worse it got. What sort of wall? Another rational-sounding question that made no sense.
It was a whole fort, stone and brick. They'll finish the roof later. You can't handle wooden roof beams with sorcery, not unless you go to strong Darksong, and that's dangerous, even for a sorcerer like Brill.
They say he does a lot of Darksong when no one's around, Jenny added. Liende plays for him then.
Daffod looked at Jenny.
That can't be.
I know what I know.
Anna's eyes flicked from one to the other. Both felt they were telling the truth. That was her feeling, and that meant something was wrong. Very wrong. Why is that a problem, Daffod? Her voice was as calm as if she were teaching her musical theater class. And that was wrong, too, because the more questions she asked, the fewer got answered.
Liende wouldn't do that. She wouldn't.
I know what I know, affirmed Jenny.
Stop it, snapped Anna. Daffod, you still haven't told me why you wanted a sorceress. You haven't said why it's important enough to summon one from far away. You haven't told me exactly how far this world is from mine. You seem to be why I'm here. I'd like some answers. She licked her dry lips. Try to make them clear.
Go ahead, Daffod. It be your idea.
The young man looked at the plank floor, then at Jenny, then back to the floor. His eyes did not rise to meet Anna's.
I wanted you to turn Lord Brill into red dust, like you turned Da into dust.
Keep to the point, Anna told herself, whatever the point is. How?
With sorcery, of course.
You say I have to be a sorceress, ventured Anna, pausing. The room was small and hot.
Why? The spell called for a sorceress, and you're here. Spells work or they don't. It worked. That means you're a sorceress.
Confused as she felt, even Anna could follow that logic, and she held in a shiver. Wonderful. She was either dead, dying, hallucinating, or truly in another world or time where they thought she was a sorceress. Anna pursed her lips. She didn't like any of the choices, and she'd thought Ames after Irenia's death had been bad.
I can handle this, she told herself silently. I can handle this.
Daffod spelled for a strong sorceress, Jenny added. You must be very strong.
Could I have another cup of water? Anna asked, wondering what she was supposed to do next. A strong sorceress who didn't even know what sorcery was. She didn't know whether to cry or laugh or just break down and sob.
I can handle this, she repeated. Whatever this is.
5. Mensha de Falk. A single chord ending in a discordant minor reverberates from the silver harp that stands on the pedestal in the middle of the marble basin.
What now?
The resonant baritone voice is far more impressive than the slender and balding man who speaks. Circles ring his brown-flecked green eyes as he walks to the harp. His eyes drop to the ripples that disrupt the image in the silvered surface, that of a blonde woman in a brown cloak.
I did not do it, Lord Brill, sir. Not me.
The youth in the short blue tunic backs toward the narrow door through which he has just hurried.
You could not have done this, Jero.
Brill's eyes study the vanishing image, taking in the green gown that shows from under the blonde woman's cloak, the rough-walled cottage, and the brown-haired songstress.
Jenny. Oh, Jenny.
His eyes flick to the fading black-haired figure in the corner.
Daffod. Well, we'll just have to do something about this. Yes, we will.
Jero backs up until he shivers silently in the arch of the doorway.
The cloak,
Brill murmurs, then reaches for the harp and strums it gently.
Hold this image in my sight. Keep it fresh. Keep it bright.
He replaces the harp and watches for a time as the image in the mirrored water sharpens, and as the woman removes the strange cloak with arms to display the magnificent green gown she wears. She also carries a large leather wallet that looks to be of green leather that matches the gown. Brill frowns once more as the blonde woman sits on the stool and apparently begins to question Daffod and Jenny. After a time, he speaks.
Jero, have my carriage made ready. I will need 2 guards.
Yes, sir.
You doubt that 2 will be enough?
Amusement etches the resonant tones.
No, sir, but is it not...
dangerous to try to cross the mist barriers? Very. She could have been burned. She should have been burned. Those 2 innocent idiots have not the faintest image of what they have done. But she is here. And we will see.
Yes, sir.
Brill's eyes drop back to the images in the mirrored pond. 6. Anna tried not to sigh after she took another swallow from the earthenware mug. Let's get back to the point. Why couldn't you have found a sorceress here on Erde, is it? Daffod looked down at the planks again, just like a student who hadn't learned his music. Instead of answering her, he glanced at Jenny.
A mere peek at Brill's hall?
His voice was almost plaintive. Jenny glared at Daffod, but he just looked back dumbly, his big dark eyes wide and imploring. After what seemed an interminable silence, Jenny cleared her throat.
If you would not mind, lady.
Anna. No, I would not mind. Maybe, just maybe, whatever Jenny did would shed some light on what these people called sorcery.
Daffod? The looking song?
Daffod turned slowly and lifted the viola out from its case. Then came the bow, and he lifted the instrument to his shoulder and tucked it under his chin. Then he stroked the bow across the strings. Jenny turned toward the mirror and cleared her throat, then lifted her hand and gave a rough tempo, then dropped the hand. Daffod began to play, and Jenny to sing.
Mirror, mirror, on my wall, show now me the Lord Brill's hall. Show it bright, and show it fast, and make that strong view well last.
The mirror shimmered, then filled with colors. Anna swallowed and looked at the scene in the wall mirror. A blue carriage rolled through a gate in a tall stone wall, pulled by 4 black horses. The gates looked to be of heavy timbers, and there were turrets or guard towers on each side of the wall above the gate. Sorcery? Was it just the combination of words, songs, and accompaniment? Just. Anna almost laughed. Jenny's words, simple as they had sounded, had been perfectly pitched and matched to Daffod's equally simple melody. She doubted that many undergraduate students could have done that well, and that didn't take into account the words.
There be Lord Brill's carriage on its way here, no doubt, Jenny said dryly.
Here? Anna asked.
He has a magic pool that tells him everything, Daffod said glumly, closing the viola and bow up in the canvas case.
We had best leave. You can go to my sister Delilah's in Sinope. Lord Brill can't leave Mensha until Lord Barjum's fort is done,
Daffod said hurriedly. Why would I want to go to Sinope? Anna glanced from Daffod to Jenny. By the way, where is Sinope?
You have to go.
I'd like to know why, Anna persisted. Once again, it felt like all the people around her were making the decisions.
You just have to.
Why? Daffod looked to Jenny.
You asked for a strong sorceress, Jenny said.
Young Daffod, I'm not going anywhere just because someone says so, Anna explained. Why should I flee? Will this Lord Brill try to turn me into dust with a song? Daffod winced.
That's what he did to Da.
It doesn't matter, Daffod, Jenny said. Lord Brill's carriage is already too close, and your mount couldn't outrun it carrying double.
Daffod sighed. Anna wanted to sigh as well. Had her insistence on trying to figure out the situation just made it that much worse? Was her life always going to be like that? A choice between reacting blindly, not knowing the situation, or trying to figure out the unknown rules and finding she was hopelessly behind by the time she did figure them out.
Let's go and meet him, she suggested. Much as she hated confrontation, she'd learned long ago that running from it only made things worse.
Again, the other two exchanged the kind of glance that confirmed they thought she was truly out of her mind. Anna stood, folded the unnecessary trench coat over her arm, and picked up her purse. She walked toward the door she hoped was the right one. Daffod stepped forward and opened the heavy wooden door, and Anna could sense the oven-like heat outside. No wonder everyone wore such light clothes. She stepped out onto the porch. Despite the shade provided by the overhanging eaves, the air seemed to scorch her, almost taking her breath away, and, under her gown, she could feel the near-instant perspiration building. The sun seemed high in the sky. It certainly wasn't late afternoon, as it had been in Ames. She glanced at her watch. The hands showed 5:40, and she didn't think they were moving. She looked again. The brass of the watch looked tarnished somehow. It was an inexpensive watch, a cheap replacement for the one her father had given her when she'd gotten her master's. The graduation watch had broken beyond repair the same week Irenia had been killed. Anna swallowed, trying to ignore the fact that her new watch had stopped, that her daughter was dead, that all too many things, and the heat, by studying what she could see of Mensha. Perhaps 100 feet from where she stood was another cottage, low and thick-walled with stucco or plaster peeling away from the cross-woven stick frame in places. A few browned stalks drooped in a square, stone-ringed space that had once been a garden. To her right, across a rutted dirt lane, was another cottage, one whose plaster appeared intact, and whose small garden was green rather than brown. Daffod joined her, carrying his viola case. As Anna looked at the young man, she realized that she was almost as tall as he was, and that she towered over Jenny. At 5'4", she wasn't that tall either. Was everyone on Erde short? How big is Mensha? Anna asked after a moment.
Maybe 2 decks across?
Daffod turned toward the dirt lane.
What is a deck?
10 furrows.
Patiently, Anna asked the next question. How long is a furrow?
For a sorceress, you don't know much.
Anna asked again. How long?
10 rods.
How big is, Anna began,
10 yards in a rod.
And a yard is about this long? Anna approximated 36 inches with her hands.
Something like that,
Daffod answered,
looking from her back toward the lane. How many people live in Mensha?
100 households, perhaps, answered Jenny as she closed the door to the cottage behind her.
Anna wanted to scream. Trying to find out anything would take forever, and by the time she did, everyone would think she was a dizzy blonde. How far away is Lord Brill's palace?
He has a hall, not a palazzo, snorted Daffod. Only the Nezareans have palazzos.
I'd like to see how well you do in my world, Anna snapped.
His hall can't be far, not if his carriage would catch us immediately. Daffod gestured toward the cottage wall, as if pointing through the structure.
It's on the hill, overlooking the Sinope Road. That's less than 3 decks.
He added, as if anticipating a question,
That's not quite half a league.
A league?
10 decks.
Anna's thoughts swirled with the unfamiliar measurements, but she guessed that Brill's hall was south of Mensha, assuming that directions weren't as strange as everything else on Erde. What should she do? Daffod hadn't wanted her to meet Brill, yet he seemed resigned. What should I watch for with Lord Brill? She asked. Daffod's mouth opened, then closed. Go on, she said. You don't trust him, but you seem to think that I'll do what he wants just because I wouldn't do what you wanted.
He talks fine, lady, Jenny said. They say he's a fine wit and offers a right good table, but many folk leave his hall changed.
Changed?
Or with the wind, like dust.
Daffod bit off each word and spat it out.
They think he's a right fine lord, when they didn't when they went to sup, Jenny said.
Sorcery? Anna asked.
What else?
Asked Daffod.
Speaking of the Lord Brill, that dusted be his carriage, Jenny offered, pointing past the yellowing oak and beyond the lane.
Anna could see a smudge of brown beyond several huts or hovels. Compared to them, Jenny's cottage was palatial. Anna wanted to shake her head. Instead, she used her handkerchief to blot her forehead, gently. For what it was worth, she didn't need smeared makeup on top of everything else.
Has to be, said Daffod. Besides Isolde's, he's got the only carriage in Mensha. And Isolde's sent his wife to Wei. She took the carriage.
Anna looked at Daffod, wishing he would explain. The young man saw her look.
You wouldn't know that. Some say the Dark Ones are going to send their gray legions through the Sand Pass before winter. That's why Lord Barjum's here. He paid Lord Brill solid silver to raise that fort. Last fall, in the dry months, not that they have not all been dry, he had Brill raise a dam just beyond the pass road. Elwes told me that there's a moat there where they can open a water gate and wash away anyone below the wall.
Against the Dark Ones, it won't be enough, offered Jenny.
The sound of hoofs on hard soil and the faint rumble of iron tires announced the arrival of the coach. Anna turned back toward the lane as the carriage rolled across the parched ground almost to the porch of the cottage, where the blue-clad driver reined in the 4 blacks. The carriage rolled to a halt. The blue lacquered finish gleamed in the hazy afternoon sunshine, and the door flipped open. A slender and balding man, attired entirely in blue velvet, stepped out. Without a word, the sorcerer, or whatever he was, stepped onto the porch. In her heels, Anna was slightly taller than he was, but he doffed his velvet cap and bowed.
You do us honor, noble lady. I am Lord Brill.
Despite the kindly appearing smile and the faint twinkle in his eye, Anna didn't feel quite right about the sorcerer. He didn't call her a sorceress, Anna noted. Did that mean he wasn't sure or he was being polite? What should she do? With a curtsy, the affected kind all the mezzo-sopranos used, she replied,
You do me the honor, lord.
I would like to do you greater honor, lady, by offering my hall as your residence for so long as you find necessary.
You are indeed kind, as well as honorable. Anna didn't quite choke on the words. Just think of it like university politics, she told herself. Just more politics. Most kind. How honorable Brill might be was another question.
Might I inquire as to how you prefer to be called?
I am Anna.
Lady Anna,
mused the sorcerer.
Neither the pools nor the books offer guidance for that name, and that may prove most liberating. We all could use some freedom in dealing with the Dark Ones.
He smiled again.
But I stray from your comfort.
Anna offered a smile, the polite, political kind that wasn't quite automatic.
Well, young Daffod, said Brill cheerfully, turning to the black-haired young man. Like always, you've done the right thing for the wrong reason. And both you and Lady Anna were lucky, most lucky. And so were you, Jenny. Great works from innocence. Still, the Dark Ones are on the move, and Lord Bargem would give his left leg for a true sorceress. I trust you'll be back in your quarters before supper.
Yes, sir,
Daffod bowed.
As for you, Jenny, we may be needing you as well.
Brill smiled and added pleasantly,
I wouldn't be traveling too far.
Yes, Lord Brill.
Jenny inclined her head. The sorcerer turned back to Anna, his eyes and mouth smiling.
If you would, do you need assistance?
I'm fine.
Anna took the two wooden steps off the porch and walked across the dirt that seemed to grab at her high heels. She paused at the iron step to the carriage, marveling at the details, from the scrolled ironwork to the velvet-upholstered seats and the brass-impressed panels above the seat backs.
You will find it quite comfortable, I'm certain,
Brill said reasonably.
I apologize for the long step up, but one doesn't find mounting blocks everywhere.
I'll manage.
Anna took a slightly deeper breath and, holding the right-hand railing, also lacquered in blue, pulled herself up and into the carriage. As she sat down, more heavily than she intended, she could almost feel the carriage flex. Brill stepped up into the carriage and closed the lacquered metal door, sealing the heat in with them. He sat on the side seat opposite Anna, his back to the driver. Without explaining, he hummed for an instant, then sang.
Cool this space and chill the air. Keep us healthy, fresh, and fair.
When the sorcerer finished, the heat receded, almost as though the carriage were air-conditioned. He wiped his forehead and took a deep breath.
That will not last long, but long enough for us to reach my hall. It is a far more suitable place for a lady such as you.
The brown-flecked eyes twinkled as the balding man boldly studied Anna. Anna again caught the humorous overtones in the words. And why might that be, Lord Brill? Brill made a gesture toward the small carriage windows whose perfect glass revealed the sun-baked and cracked ground, the yellow-tinged oak tree at the end of the cottage, and the two figures on the porch.
Is it not obvious?
Anna nodded slowly, but ever since leaving Avery and before, she had come to distrust the obvious, especially when someone pointed it out.
You offer a gesture of agreement, Lady Anna, but not one that is more than perfunctory.
I guess I'm inclined to reserve judgment on many things until I'm more familiar with your world.
Is that why you did not ride off with young Daffod?
Brill laughed softly.
I do not read thoughts, but he was angry. He wrote the spell that summoned you and taught it to Jenny, obviously. She is a rote sorceress, adequate, but without much inspiration. Still, it is enough to gain her a house as a woman alone, and that is much in these days. He is talented, but his voice is not good enough to hold spells. His playing is far better than his father's, and he doesn't hum that distracting monotone the way Culain did. Young Daffod still does not understand how often or how deeply his father has jeopardized me, or how much he jeopardized you.
You turned him into dust for humming? Asked Anna, her voice as emotionless as she could make it.
What else could I do? He kept getting worse, and if I let him go, he'd have been picked up by the Dark Ones in days, and they'd have the fruits of my works to use against Defalk.
Anna's eyes flicked from the earnest-sounding sorcerer to the windows at the change in the sound of the carriage team's hoofs. The carriage was headed down a stone-paved street, with a handful of buildings on either side, but both pavement and buildings passed quickly, and the carriage seemed headed away from the town.
Here, unlike your world, Lady Anna, sorcery is a dangerous business. The slightest improper inflection, the wrong thought image of a word, or any distraction can cause a spell to fail, or to have unintended consequences.
Anna frowned. Hadn't Daffod said that spells either worked or failed? Was Brill lying? The inside of the carriage was getting warmer, and she wanted to rub her forehead.
You understand, I see, but young Daffod does not.
Brill sighed.
I can only hope he will come to understand before it is too late.
Anna pursed her lips. None of it made sense. If Brill were so evil, and if he could turn someone into dust, why hadn't he just turned Daffod into dust? Or was that because he needed Anna? Was Daffod what he seemed? But she usually had a good sense of people, and the young man had impressed her as honest. Confused, but honest. And what about Daffod being lucky, or her being lucky? She already had too many questions. The carriage started uphill, and the horse's hoofs clicked once more on stone. Anna leaned forward to study the structure. The off-white stone walls were high enough not to be squat, but not high enough to soar, either. And the three sides she could see seemed to form a hexagon, with the gate she glimpsed in Jenny's mirror centered in the middle section. The walls were not crenellated, and besides the higher towers straddling the gate, there were additional towers, one at each apex of the hexagon. Impressive for something called a hall, she thought. The iron-bound gates swung shut behind the carriage with a heavy clunk that sounded as she imagined a prison door would. Anna forced a smile.
There, said the sorcerer with visible relief. I hope the Dark Ones didn't scry you, but if they did, they won't know too much.
Brill frowned.
How long were you there in Jenny's cottage?
Not very long. It was Anna's turn to frown. Why?
It would be better if they didn't know you were here.
Who and why? Brill laughed, the same amused and soft laugh.
I beg your pardon, Lady Anna. I will explain more when you are refreshed. For now, let me just say that the Dark Ones would destroy all of Leetwar and kill all of its sorcerers, including you and me, in the name of what they call reason. Since you are here, you can help.
Why should I? Anna's tone was curious.
You could be one of the most powerful sorceresses in Leetwar. Not just Defalk, but you have much to learn,
Brill answered reasonably.
Unless you want to take the risk of dying in fire, you'll need to learn about Leetwar. I intend to help you.
The carriage rolled to a gentle stop. All Anna could see through the small carriage windows were walls of identical stones, each like marble, each tinted light blue. I imagine so, she said sweetly, trying to keep from grinding her teeth.
Not for your body, lovely as it appears, but because I would prefer to remain whole and intact, and it will take the power of every sorcerer in Defalk, and all the armsmen Lord Barjum can raise, to stop the Dark Ones.
Who are the Dark Ones?
The Dark Monks of Ebra, though their sacred source is in the mountains around Volt.
More names that meant nothing, Anna thought.
I'll explain it at dinner, Brill explained,
opening the door and stepping out.
I imagine you are hungry.
He extended a hand. Anna found she didn't need it, since the carriage had indeed pulled up to what she imagined was a mounting block, or a set of stone steps designed to unload carriages. Brill gestured to a diminutive black-haired girl, not even to Anna's shoulder, who stood in the shadows at the top of the steps by the open oak door.
Florenda, will you escort the Lady Anna to the first guest suite?
Brill offered his pleasant smile once more.
We will eat at the first bell.
He turned to Anna.
That will be 2 glasses before true sunset.
Anna guessed that meant something like 2 hours before sunset, and her eyes flicked toward what she felt was the west, assuming the hazy white sun was in the western sky.
You will find some refreshments in your suite, Lady Anna,
Brill added, with another bow.
Until dinner.
Florenda bowed. If you would follow me, lady. Anna wanted to shake her head. The only time she'd ever gotten this kind of bowing and scraping was the time she'd sung the national anthem at the Peach Bowl, and that had been years ago, when Cindy What's-Her-Name had canceled less than a day before. She grasped her handbag firmly and walked up the half-dozen steps to the tall doorway that dwarfed her. Her heels clicked on the hard, light blue stone. Was the entire hall built of the same stone? The heat of the day vanished as she stepped into the hall and Florenda closed the doorway. The entry foyer rose nearly 3 stories, with a glittering brass and crystal chandelier centered in the middle of the entry, and perhaps 10 feet over her head. The stone floor was comprised of interlocking triangles of black and white, both types of stone polished so smooth that the floor glimmered as though it had been waxed and buffed. The white candles of the chandelier were unlit, and the clear crystal mantles shimmered without a single smudge. Light diffused into the entryway through high translucent skylights, triangular panes of milky blue glass set in the angular trapezoidal cupola that topped the entry foyer. Inlaid into the smooth slabs of white stone that comprised the walls were curlicues of polished brass, giving the entry hall a Moorish feel. While the cool was welcome, she had the feeling that in a cold winter, the sorcerer's hall would be chilly, very chilly. In the entryway there were no woods and no fabrics, just glass and metal and stone. Florenda waited as Anna surveyed the area, then said quietly, "The first guest suite is up off the main staircase." "How many guest suites are there?" asked Anna, following the maid through the high arch at the back of the entry hall into another vaulted hall. A stone staircase rose straight before Anna, fully 15 feet wide. On each side of the open stone-floored area at the foot of the grand staircase was another archway. 5, but none save yours are occupied. That doesn't count the great lord's suite. Florenda lowered her voice. Few would visit Mencia by choice now, even for comforts like those supplied by Lord Brill. Anna wondered why, if Brill were such a powerful sorcerer, he just didn't leave the area, since he could clearly build himself a great hall anywhere. She decided to keep the question to herself for the moment. The reception hall is there, Florenda pointed to the left, and the grand dining room is there. She pointed to the right. Your dinner tonight will be in the salon off the grand dining room. With that, the maid headed up the stone steps. Anna followed more cautiously, her free hand on the stone balustrade, wondering if her heels would slip on the smooth stone, since the steps were neither carpeted nor covered. After reaching the top of the staircase, she faced yet another carved archway that led down a wide hall. This is your key, lady. Florenda stopped at the first door on the right and offered Anna a shining brass key with an ornately swirled top. The door, framed in golden wood, had 8 diamond-shaped panels, each lacquered in dark blue. The keyhole was outlined in the same shining brass.
There are gowns and less formal wear in the closets in the wardrobing area, and some should fit you. If you choose to alter some, Lord Brill would not mind.
Thank you.
How was she supposed to alter something? With sorcery?
Florinda turned the levered door handle and opened the door.
There is also an iron bolt inside. If you need any assistance, you only need summon me with the bell pull.
She bowed again, apparently waiting for Anna to enter the suite. Anna reached out and touched the door lever. It moved easily and the door opened inward.
7. East of the Sand Pass, Ebra.
Light seems to bend away from the interior of the tent. Behind the collapsible wooden writing desk is a simple armless stool. On it sits a figure in a pale brown hooded habit. Though his clean-shaven chin is visible in the light that filters in through the tent flap as it moves in the breeze, the remainder of his face is in shadow. The figure standing before the writing desk also wears a hooded habit.
Songmaster, Lord Barjum is raising additional defense works to support his forts on Defalk's side of the Sand Pass. Much good they will do him. And a portal to one of the Mist Worlds has been opened.
Where?
The songmaster stops writing on the heavy linen paper scroll.
In Defalk.
Defalk? How? A mist portal takes the lyric voice, and none there have the power. Are you sure of this, Brother Burthen?
As sure as we can be. The opening plucked the strings of Erde, and the echoes still whisper on her strings.
Was the portal opened from the mist side?
Brother Burthen shook his head.
Discovering it took some time, Songmaster. All we could determine is that a strange blonde woman, in an exotic green gown, went from a cottage in the hamlet of Mensha to Lord Brill's hall.
A single sorceress will not stop us, even one that has escaped the fires of passage. But how she did?
A shrug follows.
That matters not now.
If she is allied with Brill,
Brill always turns and runs when matters become difficult. Why should this time be any different?
The sorceress might change matters.
The hint of a smile crosses the songmaster's face, visible only on the unshadowed portion of his mouth.
She would have to be powerful indeed.
His hall is warded,
pointed out Burthen, as if the songmaster had not smiled at all.
Watch it, as you can. We will proceed with the day's works. Contact the Dark Chapter in Falkor and see what more they can discover about the portal, and if the woman is a sorceress.
One sorceress cannot prove that great a problem, suggested Burthen.
I would prefer to have no problems.
Yes, Songmaster.
The Songmaster continues to write, slowly, on the song scroll before him, long, long after Burthen has left the dimness of the tent. 8. Anna stepped into the room, a medieval, or Erdish, version of a presidential suite, more than 30 feet long and nearly as wide from the door to the windows. On the outside wall, blue-tinted but clear floor-to-ceiling windows offered a panorama of both the walls to Brill's stronghold and the cottages and lanes of Mensha, downhill and to the north. That had to mean that the hall's walls weren't that high. Anna frowned, recalling that the hall was on a hilltop. Probably the walls were a lot higher on the outside than the inside. The windows were flanked with heavy blue hangings drawn back with thick blue cording. Before the window was an elegant stone table, flanked by a pair of blue lacquered chairs. The large and high bed was covered with a pale blue spread trimmed in white lace. In the center of the spread was the letter B, in a royal blue. On each side of the bed were delicate-appearing stone tables, on each a brass and crystal oil lamp.
"The wardrobing area is through that door," offered Florenda.
Anna crossed the room and slipped through the smaller door into a room that contained a raised stone tub that would have fit four of her, a long stone vanity that included a sink, and two walls comprised of open closets half-filled with clothing. Beside the left end of the vanity was a full-length mirror. It showed a bewildered-looking and slightly disheveled singer in a green formal gown, carrying a rumpled raincoat. Florenda pointed to a curtained alcove in the outer wall.
"The Jakes is there."
Jakes? The word wasn't familiar, but Anna understood the idea. There was some form of indoor plumbing, at least for the wealthy, although she certainly was no stranger to an outhouse, not after the summers at Uncle Garvin's Appalachian farm up in the holler beyond Bear Paw.
"If you need anything," Florenda repeated, "just use the bell pull in the bedroom or the robing room."
She pointed to a long blue rope beside the stone vanity. Then she bowed.
"Unless you have any immediate needs."
"No, no, you can go." Anna just wanted a few minutes to think. Things kept getting more and more confusing. She walked to the door of the corridor, following Florenda. As soon as the maid stepped out, Anna closed the door and threw the iron bolt. Wasn't there something about iron being proof against magic? Or was that a superstition? She wandered toward the bed, noting that the frame was beautifully wrought metal of some sort, again covered with the almost shimmering blue lacquer that seemed everywhere. After laying the coat on the coverlet, gently, she lifted the stiff fabric, noting the stitching wasn't that much better than her own, and certainly not as good as her mother's. The bed even felt lumpy, and she frowned again. She turned and walked toward the window, still carrying her handbag, looking at the hangings, a sort of velvet, but with a weave that was almost shoddy in comparison to the rest of the room. She pulled out one of the chairs. Delicate as it looked, it was heavy, as if it were solid iron, and the small cushion on the seat, embroidered with another B, appeared somewhat frayed. The brass tray on the table contained a small loaf of bread, what appeared to be slices of dried apple, and a handful of narrow yellow cheese wedges. Anna set the green purse on one side of the circular stone table, broke off a corner of the dark bread, and chewed the small morsel. Although slightly tough, the bread offered a good taste, like a cross between pumpernickel and rye. She had another mouthful, then looked at the crystal pitcher and the pair of matching crystal goblets. She sniffed the pitcher, but the amber-colored liquid offered a bitter, familiar but unfamiliar tang, even faintly musty. Gingerly, she poured a small amount into the goblet and took the smallest of sips. Ooh. While it might have once passed for wine, the liquid tasted more like vinegar. Anna licked her lips and picked up the clean goblet, carrying it into the robing room. There were two levered faucets into the stone tub. Anna picked the left one and turned it. A thin trickle of steaming water flowed out. Hastily, she closed the first lever and opened the second. A wider stream of cool water poured from the faucet, and she slipped the goblet under the lukewarm stream for a moment, then turned the lever off. Water. But did she dare drink it? She looked at the water in the goblet, thinking about Jenny and the girl's claim about spelling water. The water looked clean. Still, she wondered. She thought about that song Mario used to sing endlessly. He picked it up from an old Frankie Lane album, something about cold, clear water. All day I faced the barren waste without a taste of cool, clear water. That wouldn't do. She rummaged through her purse and finally came up with a stub of a pencil and the envelope that had contained her last pay stub. She began to write, not that she was any writer, Avery or Sandy or even Irenia. She shook her head and tightened her lips. "Don't think about it," she ordered herself. "Not now." Angrily, she scrawled out the words. She looked at the rough verse on the rumpled envelope. It was terrible, but not much worse than the couplets Brill had sung to cool the carriage. She cleared her throat and tried to vocalize.
Holly lolly polly pop.
Finally, she looked down at the verse.
Ready or not?
She cleared her throat, then tried the words with as much inflection as she could, emphasizing cold and clean. All day I faced this barren waste without a taste of cold, clean water. Give now my glass in lovely place a healthful taste of cold, clean water. Anna could feel something, and she looked at the goblet, where frost appeared around the rim. Then virtually instantly the water froze and the goblet shattered, and Anna looked down dumbly at shards of crystal and a lump of clear, solid ice. She shook her head, as cold inside as the ice before her. As the saying went, she wasn't in Kansas anymore, nor in Iowa. She certainly wasn't. Her eyes burned, even as a sense of subdued excitement held her. It was good news and bad news again. Like the good news had been that Avery had left, and that had been the bad news, since he'd left nothing for her or the children. Here, the good news was that she could cast spells. The bad news was that she was really in a different world, where she could cast spells. She looked down at the mess again. There didn't seem to be anything for waste disposal, so she used a crust of bread to sweep the crystal into a small pile, and then she carried the chunk of ice, free of glass, to the sink to let it melt. After that, she took a sip of the vinegar wine, rather than repeat the water spell. Who knew what she'd get the next time? She also tried the cheese, but the slightest taste gave her the hint of mold, and she set the wedge down. The apple slices weren't bad, if slightly like rubber. In the end, she ate most of the bread and half the apples, leaving the cheese. Feeling better, she realized the room remained cool, as if a breeze blew from the windows. She walked to the windows again. While they were hinged, they were closed. Underneath each was a louver, and cool air came through the louvers. She extended her hand toward the metal louvers, but stopped short as she felt the chill. Sorcery? The louvers opened to the outside air, but somehow changed the hot air to cold air. She was supposed to have dinner with the sorcerer, and she felt like a mess, even if she hadn't done that much. But she'd changed worlds, and she'd sweated and been shocked and surprised. Anna glanced around the palatial bedchamber, then headed into the robing room, where she found a set of towels, small, clean, and tending toward the frayed. She looked at her watch. The hands still showed 5:40. Didn't Erde have time? Or had the transition destroyed the watch, or what? Or had the battery run out? More questions for which she had no answers. She reclaimed her purse and brought it into the robing room, where she found a bottle of what appeared to be liquid soap, strong smelling. She used the smallest dab with lots of lukewarm water from the tap to remove the grime she hadn't even realized had built up on her hands. Then, with the smallest towel as a washcloth, using mostly water, she dabbed and blotted her face clean before reapplying her makeup. That done, she went back into the bedroom and looked from the two hard chairs to the bed. She didn't want to lie down and wrinkle the gown, but the chairs were small and hard. She walked to the window and looked out, but the scene remained unchanged, although she did see a man in armor walking along the ramparts of the hold with a bow and quiver slung across his back and some sort of sword in a scabbard. What was Erde? A place where people could be transported by magic, but used horses and carriages? Where sorcerers turned people into dust, but the weapons were bows and blades? Where castles were elaborate and ornate and finely built, but where cloth was rough and where the hangings and embroidery were equally crude? The contradictions didn't make sense. Was that why she still had a feeling of unreality? Finally, she sat down on the hard chair, letting her thoughts go where they would. A gentle knocking roused her, and she realized she had been half-dozing as she had been sitting before the table, half-propped up with arms and elbows. Yes? The knocking persisted, and Anna remembered she had bolted the door. She stood, walked over to it, and answered again. Yes? Lady Anna, it is about time for dinner. Florenda's voice was muffled, but clear enough. Anna undid the bolt and opened the door. I'll be there in just a moment. Florenda bowed.
You look most beautiful.
Thank you, Anna replied, taking the compliment more as a testimony to fear in her supposed powers than in her appearance. She gathered her handbag, not wanting to leave it behind, and followed Florenda back down the wide hallway and the grand staircase. They turned left at the bottom of the wide stone steps. The grand dining room contained a wide stone table nearly 30 yards long, dark under unlit chandeliers. A single gong, or chime, echoed through the lofty space, adding to the sense of desertion. Anna had the feeling that the room was seldom used as she followed Florenda to the open double doors at the end of the dining room. Warm light filled the salon, a space not much larger than her bedchamber.
Lady Anna, punctual as well as beautiful.
Lord Brill, still in the blue velvet jacket and trousers, rose from a carved wooden chair, upholstered in a blue needlepoint. The armchair was the first wooden chair Anna had seen. Florenda slipped back and closed the salon doors. Lord Brill, you are most complimentary and hospitable. Anna inclined her head.
These days we must be hospitable. Good company is most scarce. Please be seated. That should accommodate your gown.
Brill gestured to the wide blue velvet settee, also framed in dark-stained carved wood.
You're from one of the mist worlds, and, despite your poise, it's clear that Erde is strange.
He walked toward the small wooden bookcase set between the tall blue-tinted windows, a bookcase with 4 tall shelves that contained perhaps 100 volumes.
Would you like some refreshments?
Not for a moment, thank you. I did appreciate those you had placed in my room. Thank you. Anna slipped onto the settee, aware that the upholstery was uneven. Was it stuffed with horsehair, like all the antiques collected by Avery's Aunt Lorinda? Beautiful, but uncomfortable?
It was the least I could do.
Brill offered the ingratiating smile.
Our dinner will be here shortly.
His left hand gestured toward the small table placed in an oversized bay window at the end of the salon. The setting was for 2. Anna nodded politely and waited.
I've seen some of your worlds, with great metal birds that fly, metal warships of the kind where one would sink all the navies of Erde. Yet you are surprised by the form of sorcery here.
Yes, Anna said, admitting nothing the sorcerer clearly didn't know already.
Sorcery does work differently here, and far fewer people employ it,
Brill said in an offhand manner. Fewer?
Everyone seems to be able to employ magic carriages in your world, Brill said, and other magical devices.
He looked quizzically at Anna, then smiled.
I seemed to have misunderstood what I have seen. Do tell me about your world.
The sorcerer's pleasant smile set off alarm bells all the way through her, and she forced an equally pleasant smile back, her mind spinning. What could she say? What on earth could she possibly say? You have seen my world, she said slowly. There is not too much I could add, but I have seen little of yours. She offered another smile. Perhaps if you told me more about this world, is it called Erde, then I could explain the differences better. That was true enough, since she didn't have the faintest idea what such differences were.
Information for information. Brill nodded. I will tell you a bit, and then we will dine, and we will talk.
He cleared his throat.
Where should I begin?
Explain about Erde. Daffod mentioned something about dark ones and great dangers, but that was about all. Anna smiled brightly. She felt as though she were pasting the smile in place.
Erde. Erde is the world. She is governed by the laws of music and by the influence of the moons, dark song and clear song. She is also governed by iron, cold iron. That seems to be true to a degree in all worlds,
Brill added sardonically.
The dark monks are a new force in the world, new in the sense that their brotherhood dates back only a few decades, but already they have taken over Ebra and threaten both Defalk and Ranuok, although the matriarch of the Ranuans insists that the Dark Ones are no danger.
Why are they dangerous? Anna asked.
Because they used massed voices to create dark song. They can sometimes change the weather, and there are those that claim the hot and dry years that have recently plagued Defalk are their doing.
You're one of those who believes this, Anna said flatly. Brill shrugged and offered the quick, warm smile.
I cannot prove that, but yes, I do believe that they have meddled with the weather.
The smile vanished.
They will do worse in the seasons ahead.
I'm not clear on the difference between dark song and clear song. Anna didn't even know what they were, except that they had something to do with the way sorcery was practiced on Erde, but there was no reason to confess to total ignorance. A ghost of a frown flitted across the sorcerer's face before he spoke.
You have seen that the world can be recorded to some degree by manipulating the music that binds its components together. The stronger the aspects of the spell, the more effective it is.
Anna nodded. That made a strange sort of sense.
But there are two sets of bindings on Erde, those that bind the living, or once living, and those that bind the non-living. It is dangerous to attempt to manipulate the living, and difficult.
But those who do are the Dark Singers? She asked.
Yes.
Brill looked vaguely disconcerted. And the Dark Ones?
They use some clear song, too, in dealing with the weather. That's because a single voice doesn't have enough power, even with a large number of supporting players.
The sorcerer paused, then added,
Your gown would indicate that you are, in fact, one of the great ones.
Anna wondered at the pause, as though Brill were having trouble finding the appropriate word. I'm considered to have a moderately strong voice. In my world, it's hard to make it, especially if you have children.
You're a sorceress, and you have children.
Brill's voice was not quite unbelieving. Three, Anna swallowed. They are grown. They certainly were by the standards of this world, and she didn't want to try to explain. One was killed in a car accident, a magic carriage accident, she added.
How old are they?
Brill asked, clearly confused. 24 and 18, the oldest was 28. Anna enjoyed the look of total confusion on the sorcerer's face.
Years or seasons? Do they grow up more quickly?
Years. Probably we grow up more slowly from what I've seen so far, Anna said. Brill sat down slowly in his padded chair.
Daffod, I wouldn't have...
The warm smile returned.
You do indeed present a welcome surprise, perhaps a greater surprise than many would expect.
He stood and gestured toward the table, extending a hand to Anna.
Let us dine.
She took his hand, a normal, warm male hand, and rose. She could smell the faint odor of sweaty male. Deodorants didn't go with magic, she gathered. Brill dropped her hand, without squeezing, and gestured toward the place on the right. The play setting included a folded, faded blue linen napkin, a blue china plate with the bee fired in place in the center, edged in a gold trim, a silver spoon more like a soup spoon, and a small, sharp knife. There was no fork. The two chairs at the table were both finished in metallic blue lacquer with blue cushions. Brill pulled out her chair with both hands, and Anna almost nodded to herself. The chair was heavy. The outer walls of the keep, or hall, shaded the blue-tinted windows from the glare of the sun low in the sky, Anna suspected, from the angle and depth of the shadows in the courtyard. The area she could see from the window was empty. No retainers, no guards. She looked back to the sorcerer.
I must apologize in advance, lady. Our fare here is limited.
The sorcerer lifted a crystal bell and rang it before seating himself. As the tones echoed through the salon, a white-haired woman in the faded blue that all Brill's servitors and employees, if that was what they were, wore, appeared with a small tray. Silently, the server placed a half-melon in front of each of them. The melon had a bright orange interior and a yellow-green rind, like a cousin of a cantaloupe.
The melons are probably the best part of the meal,
Brill noted, reaching for a crystal carafe containing the same amber vinegar wine. No, thank you, Anna said quickly.
You do not like the wine.
Anna scarcely would have called it wine. I'd prefer clean, cold water, if you don't mind.
Some sorcerers do, I've discovered. The blue pitcher has water in it.
He filled his own goblet with the amber wine. Do you have to spell all the water here? Anna asked, pouring the water into the empty goblet.
I do. All the water used in the hall is clean, even the bathing water.
I see why people call your hall a palace of wonders. Anna wasn't so sure she was happy about a world where it was considered excessively cautious to purify the bathing water.
Jenny said that. Generous of her. It couldn't have been Daffod. He wouldn't offer me a kind word.
You don't seem bothered by his dislike of you. Anna used the small, sharp knife to cut away a bite-sized slice of the melon, slipping it into her mouth. It was warmer than she liked melon, half honeydew, half cantaloupe, but sweet and refreshing. She cut another slice.
I'd dislike me were I in his boots.
Brill took a sip of the wine.
Not too bad.
Why would you dislike yourself if you were Daffod?
I killed his father. It was necessary because Culain's humming was getting worse and he wouldn't listen.
Brill set down the fluted goblet.
Lady Anna, using Spellsong is always dangerous. You said your daughter died in a magic carriage accident. It is much the same way here on Erde. My father tried to use Spellsong too long. There was less of him left than of Culain.
Brill laughed, a sound with bitter overtones.
Of course, it didn't help that he tried to turn a thunderstorm on Lord Barjum's grandfather.
Anna shook her head. Your father was...
Politics. They're always complicated. Barjum was raised by his uncle. Donjum was the older son, but none of his children lived. Barjum and I don't care much for each other personally, but he needs a sorcerer, and I, obviously, need silver.
Just as you need Daffod, Anna guessed.
Precisely. I thought you might understand. Daffod is a good player, and I would certainly not take askance if you remained friendly with him. Do keep in mind that, like all players, he has a tendency to react, rather than consider the effects of his efforts.
Anna cut another slice of melon and chewed slowly, trying to gather her thoughts together. Brill cut himself a wedge of melon larger than Anna's and popped it into his mouth with relish. It's often hard to consider the future when you are struggling with the present, Anna temporized.
If you don't, you often have no future.
If you don't eat today, countered Anna, you may not live long enough to worry about a future. Even on Erde, it appeared, there were the elitists who preached about preparing for tomorrow, while conveniently forgetting that too many people had trouble getting through today. Elitists like Avery, who used his money on vacation homes, while insisting that she share in the children's college tuition costs, while preaching that she hadn't saved enough after she'd followed him everywhere and given up her chances at tenure to try to let him have his big chance.
If I were to allow people to use seed grain for flour, we'd all have starved,
Brill said coolly. Anna swallowed her retort, realizing that she couldn't afford to make the sorcerer angry, just like she couldn't afford to make her department chair angry, her thesis advisor angry, Avery angry. Instead, she took a last slice of melon and chewed it slowly, looking out the window into the still empty courtyard. It can be a hard choice, she finally said.
Hard indeed, and I am often called cruel for it.
Brill refilled his goblet with the amber wine.
All prudent lords are in this time of trouble.
The white-haired server removed the melons, leaving the plates, then used a crude spatula to lever a brown-covered slab of meat onto Anna's plate. Next came a whitish-green heap of something. Finally, she set a steaming loaf of the brown bread in the center of the table. Brill nodded at the server, who departed as silently as she had slipped into the salon. Anna looked at the brown sauce that covered the hefty slice of meat. The sauce reminded her of all the mystery meats she hadn't eaten when she'd been studying in England. She tried to sniff the meat without being too obvious.
It's not the best beef, the sorcerer admitted, but the sauce is good. Only the tougher animals have been able to weather the drought.
How long has the drought continued? Asked Anna, using the knife to slice a sliver of beef.
This is the fourth year.
Brill cut a large chunk of meat and eased the entire portion into his mouth. Anna repressed a shudder, although she'd seen Mario do the same thing all too often. She chewed her small slice, tough despite a marinated sauce that was sweet and acidic simultaneously. If what the sorcerer was putting in front of her happened to be good food, she wasn't sure she wanted to find out what the common folk ate. Because of the Dark Ones,
it appears that way. Ebra is getting good rains, and the Ebrans are selling melons and grains to the Ranoans and the Norwayans. Before they took over, the weather was spotty there.
The sorcerer cut another slice off his slab of meat and stuffed it into his mouth, wiping his fingers on the necessarily large napkin, then breaking off a chunk of bread. After that, he took and ate another enormous chunk of meat. Why are they doing it? Asked Anna, not quite sure what she was asking. What do you think? She followed Brill's example and took a corner of the bread. A mouthful convinced her that it was far better than the meat.
Does what I think matter? I wish I knew. Oh, I can summon images that show what they do, and that's clear enough. They spell move the whispering sands south and west, uncovering once fertile ground, and covering the groves and grasslands of Ranuuk.
Brill sipped from the goblet.
The Ranuans insist that the sands move naturally, but they must know better. The sand moving gives better crops to the Ebrans, who thank the Dark Ones and weaken the Ranuans. Beyond that, I can see that this prosperity allows them to equip and feed better and more troops. I can only guess at the planned use of those troops. The water mirrors do not read intent, as you know.
And you guess what? Anna took a sip of water and another mouthful of bread.
They will invade Defolk, sooner or later, before harvest this year or no later than next.
He shrugged.
That is but a guess.
Anna lifted the deep spoon and tried the whitish-green mess, which turned out to be something like tart and unsweetened fried apples. She had another bite.
After seeing how you preferred water, I thought you might like the sour apples.
They are good, Anna said. But I can't live on fruit alone. The dark bread is quite good, too. She followed her second spoonful of apples with another thin slice of the tough beef. The brown sauce helped, but the apples and the bread helped more. "What will you do to stop them, the dark ones?" Anna asked after several bites. The sorcerer finished yet another large mouthful of beef before he spoke.
"I have helped Lord Barjum build walls on Defalk's side of the Sand Pass, but they will only slow the armies of the Dark Ones."
He frowned.
"I had not meant to speak of it, but I had wondered whether you might have some special magic, such as the mighty weapons of your world."
Anna thought. She didn't want to admit she was essentially clueless, but how could she answer him? Finally, she spoke. "Our world is different, and the way our technology works requires many technicians. Each adds something. I am only one person."
"What is a technician?"
"A technician is like a player, I'd say, except technicians work with special tools and magic boxes called computers." Anna cleared her throat. "Everything works differently here and there."
"Yet Daffod's spell brought you," Brill pointed out.
"I may be able to help," Anna said, "but I need to learn more about Erde."
"Can you even do spells here, lady?"
asked Brill coolly. "Yes," Anna answered truthfully, glad that she had tried the water spell. "But I made a large mess out of one of your goblets."
"You broke one of them with a spell."
The frown was so momentary that Anna would have missed it had she not been concentrating on reading his reactions. "That wasn't the intent," Anna offered a gentle laugh. "I was trying to get cold and clean water. I got it so cold it froze the crystal."
"Again, you surprise me."
Brill inclined his head.
"I have never tried to freeze water. Working with water can be most dangerous. Metals and stone are generally easier."
Anna glanced down at her plate, vaguely surprised that she had eaten everything on it, and then at Brill's, despite the fact that he had easily eaten twice what she had, if not more. He was clearly trim, and without a spare ounce anywhere. Sorcery had to be hard work here. A trace of a smile crossed her lips. Maybe she wouldn't have to worry about weight. Her half-smile disappeared as she realized that she was being considered as a weapon in a war, and she knew little about either side. The sky outside the window was turning a deep purple, and the salon had gotten dimmer and dimmer. Brill hummed for a moment, then sang to the candle on the table between them.
"Candle light, candle bright, flame clear in my sight."
The candle flame appeared from nowhere, then flicked and continued to burn.
"Can you do that?"
Brill asked. "I've never heard the tune, but I can try. Would you hum it once?" Anna asked. The sorcerer obliged. Anna glanced up at the chandelier in the middle of the ceiling, then thought. She hummed the tune once, and again. Finally, she took a deep breath, hoping that she could duplicate the feat, concentrated on the mental image of a blazing chandelier, and sang, "Candle light, candles bright, flame clear in my sight." The entire chandelier blazed into light, then subsided to a warm glow. Brill wiped his forehead.
"Ah, yes, I can see that."
"I seem to have this tendency to overdo things," Anna said politely. Inside, she was half excited, half fearful, wondering how she was so successful at something she'd never done. She also tried to remember the tune Brill had hummed.
"Even the Dark Ones might be somewhat surprised," the sorcerer observed as he lifted the crystal bell and rang it.
The white-haired server appeared and removed the plates and bread, then returned with two small slices of pastry.
"Resserot,"
the sorcerer explained. Anna picked it up with her fingers and took a small bite of the layered pastry soaked in honey, almost like baklava, but without the nuts. The honey tasted slightly off, but she finished it anyway and followed it with several healthy swallows of water.
The honey is a trace strong, Brill said. I think that's because there is so little moisture.
I appreciated it all, Anna said truthfully, realizing that she had been hungry indeed, and that she could have eaten more. Brill rose, almost abruptly.
I would not presume to escort you to your chamber, Lady Anna, but I trust you will rest well.
I appreciate your hospitality, Lord, and your willingness to assist a stranger. She inclined her head.
Tomorrow, perhaps, you would enjoy a ride around the hall's grounds.
If you have a gentle horse, Anna answered, I'm out of practice. Out of practice was definitely an understatement. Except for a few trail rides with Sandy and his daughters, she hadn't been on a horse for more than 20 years. I would enjoy learning more about Erde.
We will see what we can do.
The ubiquitous Florenda was waiting at the salon door with a lamp, and Anna followed the slender woman back up to the guest chamber.
Breakfast is served at the second morning bell, lady. I will knock on your chamber door at the first bell.
Florenda bowed deeply, even more deeply than before. Thank you, Florenda. Anna offered the young woman a smile before closing and bolting the door. The coverlet had been turned back, and both bedside lamps had been lit. The window hangings had been loosed and completely covered the perfect tinted blue glass panes. The small pile of crystal had been removed, and two clean and empty goblets and a pitcher of what appeared to be water stood on the window table. Beside the lamp on the window side of the bed was a candle, like something out of an antique picture book, set in a metal holder that had a curved handle. Beside the candle holder was a metal device that looked like a combination between tongs and strange scissors. Anna shook her head and felt the sheets, somewhat coarse linen, but at least they weren't wool. She hoped Lord Brill had spelled the bed for vermin, or whatever. Of course, she couldn't sleep in her green gown, or wear it every day, either. With a sigh that was half yawn, she stepped toward the robing room, then realized that she couldn't see in the dark. That was the reason for the candle. She stepped around the bed and picked up the scissor tongs and squeezed them. A spark leapt from them. Although she understood the striker, rather than fiddling with the device, Anna hummed the tune she and Brill had used to light the candles again. It seemed easier than fiddling with the striker. This time, she sang and concentrated on getting a normal flame, and she did. With a smile, she carried the candle holder into the robing room, and after pawing through half the left-hand closet wall, she found what appeared to be a thin cotton gown. Then, in the dim candlelight, she kicked off her shoes and struggled out of the green formal and the slips and the long-line bra and the nylons. They were ruined, with runs in at least 3 places. For the moment, with another yawn, she set them aside. As she pulled on the gown, she wondered if Brill were spying, then shook her head. She hoped he wasn't. She didn't like the idea of her privacy being invaded, but she didn't have any doubts that a sorcerer who had discovered her arrival could easily use his abilities to follow her motions, dressed or undressed. Still, the shapely Florenda indicated that Lord Brill probably had his pick of local young women. So why would he bother with Anna? Had he been telling the truth with his words about not wanting her body, but her abilities? Was anyone telling the truth? She carried the candle back into the bedchamber and set it on the bedside table, cupping her hand and blowing it out, since she saw no snuffer. The cold of the stone floor on her bare feet was welcome. Sitting on the edge of the bed, she took off her jewelry last, all costume except for the ring Irenia had given her, and laid it on the bedside table with the non-functioning watch. Then she climbed between the sheets. The mattress was lumpy, as she had suspected. She tried to arrange the equally lumpy pillows and pushed back the coverlet so that she was covered only by the sheets. Finally, she blew out the lamps and lay back in the darkness and the silence. Everything seemed so real and unreal. The smells and tastes were vivid enough, especially the vinegary taste of the wine, and the crystal fragments had seemed real enough. But a world where sorcery worked, and everywhere was the same strange contrast, delicate, cultured, refined items beside crude things. What was the pattern? She shook her head in the darkness, knowing she knew the answer, but unable to grasp it in her tiredness and confusion. Finally, her eyes closed. 9. Asaria Nazaria. A sea breeze cools the columned hilltop chamber. Between the fluted marble pillars, the man in the spotless and feather-light white tunic can glimpse the white caps of the bitter sea. The music of strings, low strings, drifts from the adjoining temple of music, providing a soothing background. The man wearing the cream and green Nazarene uniform, who stands below the marble seat of music, does not appear soothed.
How did the Dark Ones first contact you, Jorbel?
The prophet of music, lord of Nazaria and the protector of the faith of the eternal melody, leans forward on the green cushion that comprises the only softness in the receiving pavilion.
I don't understand, Lord Balaam.
The uniformed man bows, as he has several times previously.
If you wish to keep using that head for understanding and other purposes, like surviving, you had best stop playing dumb, Jorbel.
The perspiration on Jorbel's forehead turns into rivulets.
Sir?
Balaam nods, and two armored and armed figures step forward. Jorbel's hands grab for the knife at his belt, for his scabbard is empty, then claw at the empty air before him. The corpse sinks forward to reveal the blade in its back.
Donkey copulators, snarls Balaam. How do they do it?
His fingers stroke the neatly trimmed reddish-blonde beard.
3 of them in the army command in the last year.
An older man, white-haired and white-bearded, steps forward. His eyes are bloodshot, with deep black circles beneath them.
He might have said more, sir.
They never do. The Dark Ones do something to them. They don't even respond to the persuasion of the strings or spells of loosening the tongue. They just start making trouble, always insisting that they have received commands I never gave.
Balaam snorts.
Why would I order Jorbel to take the blades from the armory reserves and have them forged into plowshares? Why?
Perhaps the Dark Ones are sending a message, suggests Menares.
That we should peacefully accept the rule of Dark Song and its dubious benefits?
Balaam glances toward the storm gathering beyond the breakwaters of Asaria.
Still,
he pauses.
Are you sure this is wise, Menares? We are far from Ebra, and building up the army has not been inexpensive.
Consider this, sir. All of the traitors have opposed it. Also consider the situation that faces us. Nordway is too strong for the Dark Ones.
At present,
interjects Balaam.
The Norwayans continue to expand their navy, and they refuse to trade except for solid silver. Ranawick is protected by the Whispering Sands and the Sand Hills. Asaria is our only trade port, and the Bitter Sea is often ice-packed or frozen near half the year. The overland route to Enkora can be easily severed if the Dark Ones take to Falk's eastern marches. In your uncle's time, we had access to Way through the River Nord, to Sinek, and the Sine River to Alawa.
Please, Menares, don't give me a lecture on trade or economics. I trust you for that. Perhaps I shouldn't, but we both know how good I am at that sort of thing.
A wry smile passes the older man's lips.
Very well, sir. It's very simple. If you don't take to Falk, at least the access to the Falsh and the South Pass, before the Dark Ones do, Nazaria will be a province of either Ebra or Nordway in a decade. And you're a young man.
Balaam nodded, despite the frown on his face.
Of course, if you would like to rely upon Sindith's heritage.
Balaam's eyes glitter.
You are my advisor, but some matters are best left to me, Menares.
I shouldn't have suggested.
No, you shouldn't have.
Balaam's eyes focus somewhere far distant.
I'd send her home, as you well know, except that I need the annual stipend from Mansour, and Constant would love an excuse to cut it off.
He smiles brightly, tightly, and his eyes refocus on his advisor.
You're sure this latest thing won't stop the Dark Ones?
The blonde sorceress that Lord Barjum has conjured from the mists?
Menares shrugs.
I have my doubts that any sorceress could stop the Dark Ones. But if she does, we have nothing to lose. Barjum has not the silver or the troops to hold his eastern marches against Ebra, and the west against us. Nordway would not risk an army in Defalk, and certainly not in Ebra.
Balaam stroked his beard again, as the soothing sounds of the strings drift across the hilltop from the Temple of Music. As the Prophet of Music looks away, Menares wipes his forehead. 10. Anna woke abruptly in the darkness. Where was she? She reached for the lamp, and her hand fumbled on the smooth stone of the bedside table, sending the link necklace skidding off the edge and clanking onto the stone floor. Her face itched from the scratchy pillowcases, and she could feel a lump of mattress padding, lint or horsehair or feathers or something, digging into her side. She shifted her weight and struggled upright in the dimness, sensing light beyond the heavy window hangings. Rather than try a lighting spell or the striker, groggy as she was, she could definitely understand the value of the striker. She eased her foot off the high bed and onto the cold floor. She padded across the smooth stones toward the windows, where she pulled back the hangings to a gray morning. Gray because the sun had not risen. The stone walls looked blue-gray in the pre-dawn light, and forbiddingly empty. Weren't people supposed to get up early in less technological cultures? Anna yawned and looked toward the robing room. Today she was supposed to go writing. Writing and learning more about Erde. If she were hallucinating, she certainly must have taken some fall. Anna shook her head. Erde didn't feel like a hallucination. It sure doesn't feel like Kansas, Toto. Or Iowa. And it didn't. The mattress had been lumpy, the sheets scratchy, and the room stuffy. Her joints ached, her eyes were gummy, and she wanted a toothbrush. She walked slowly into the robing room and turned on the tap, the wrong one, and quickly added lukewarm water to the steaming stream. There was a flat, rubber-like plug that fit over the drain. In struggling to get the plug to fit in place, she ended up soaking half her gown. "Damn," she muttered, looking toward the mirror as she waited for the tub to fill. The gown clung to her in all the wrong places, especially if she were being watched, magically or otherwise. She shook her head, definitely not at ease with the idea of real magic. "Are you sure you're not hallucinating?" The faint stream from the tap, the cold stone underfoot, the aches in her back, the damp gown against her skin, and her itchy nose were good indications that wherever she happened to be was real. Too real. She finally turned off the water, stripped off the gown, and eased into the tub. The warm water felt good, although she'd probably need another bath after riding, as much to relieve soreness as to remove dust. She had to sprawl half out of the tub to grab the small towel she'd used as a washcloth the day before. Then she used the oil soap sparingly, very sparingly, as she washed her face. She wished she had more than the small bottle of hand cream and the little jar of lip moisturizer. Even lotion would have been good, but she hadn't seen anything like that on Erde, and doubted that she would. The two small towels were scratchy, and her skin prickled in the cool of the robing room. Still, it was better than the heat she imagined continued outside the sorcerer's hall. She laughed ruefully. Hadn't that been the story of her life? Difficult as things seemed, they were always better than the alternatives could have been. She also needed to find some clothes that would fit for riding. The green formal gown was definitely not designed for that. With a deep breath, Anna turned toward the open closets where she found what looked to be a dressing gown. That helped with the chill. In among everything else, and Anna had to wonder just how many ladies Brill had prepared for, she found some soft green cotton trousers and a matching armless tunic, as well as a loose-fitting natural cotton blouse she could wear under the tunic. She frowned. Would both a blouse and tunic be too hot? She fingered the fabric of the blouse, or shirt. The buttons were on the right-hand side. The cotton underdrawers she found were either too tight or too baggy. Clearly, Erde hadn't discovered elastic either. She opted for comfort. Too tight might look wonderful in a fashion magazine, but she wasn't in a fashion magazine. She was in some strange world where everyone else seemed to know what was going on. Finally, she shrugged off the dressing gown and pulled on the baggy underdrawers, softer at least than any other fabric she'd felt, and then the rest of the outfit. Shoes? She certainly couldn't wear heels. On a shelf at the far end of the open were four pairs of boots, all in shades of blue, but nowhere could she find socks. Only one pair was large enough, and even those were a squeeze around her calves. When Anna had dressed and applied a little makeup and lip gloss, she studied herself in the mirror. She had to admit she didn't look too bad. The faded green flattered her complexion, even with the minimal makeup she'd had and used, and, wonder of wonders, the trousers didn't even accentuate her hips. She snorted. A strange world, and you're worrying about how your hips look. Anna looked at the green handbag on the table in the bedchamber. She didn't want to carry it, nor to leave it, especially some of the contents like the lotion, the lip moisturizer. She doubted that any of the coins were worth anything, not since the U.S. had given up honest silver and copper. That brought another rueful look to her face. Who would have thought she'd be thinking about coins? While she had carried more than a few things in her purse, the handbag she'd carried had been stripped down to essentials, as she always did for functions. She offered a wry grin to the mirror. Too bad she hadn't been headed for a theatrical performance with three bags full of stuff. For a moment, she wished she were one of those women who carried everything all the time. The trousers had no pockets, nor did the blouse, and the two patch pockets on the tunic didn't feel like they'd hold much. So how did people carry things? She went back to the closets that seemed to hold everything and began to rummage, eventually coming up with something that looked like a cross between an overgrown wallet, a purse, and a leather pouch. The leather loops were clearly designed for a belt to fit through them. As she untied the leather belt, no buckles on Erde, and slipped the wallet purse in place, she smiled ruefully. The meaning of the term cut purse was a lot clearer. By carefully nestling items together, she could even fit everything that had been her green handbag in the oversized wallet, except the brush. She set that on the table with the handbag. Then she looked at it again, finally picking it up and easing it into the left tunic pocket, bristles down. The handle stuck out, but the way things had been going, who knew where she'd be by evening? Her eyes went to the bedside table and the jewelry and her watch. She walked over and picked up the watch that still showed the time as 5:40. That was another question. Why didn't it work? Why had it and the key gotten so hot when she had been spelled into Erde, but not the necklace or her rings? Did the gold plate have anything to do with it? Finally, she strapped the watch on her wrist and the rings on her fingers, but the costume gold links went into the green handbag. If they vanished, so be it. Anna jumped at the knock on the outer door, then took a deep breath and walked to the door.
Yes? Lady, your breakfast is being served in the salon, and Lord Brill would greatly appreciate your company.
Anna fumbled with the bolt and opened the door. Florenda, I will be there momentarily.
Might I wait and accompany you, lady? Asked the dark-haired girl, her black eyes pensive.
That would be fine. Anna could sense Florenda's unease. Would the girl be punished if Anna failed to appear? Or was she politely trying to get Anna to hurry, but fearful of offending someone she thought might be a powerful sorceress? Anna left the door ajar as she studied the bedchamber, then turned. I guess I'm ready. Florenda bowed and turned. Anna followed her down the corridor, through the dimly lit rooms to the salon, where light poured through the bay window behind the table. Lord Brill rose from the small table and bowed.
Good morning, Lady Anna. I trust you rested well.
Anna returned the bow. I appreciate your courtesy and hospitality, Lord Brill. She looked down at herself. I hope you do not mind my use of the clothing, but I did not arrive exactly dressed for...
You may have anything you need, lady.
His mouth crinkled, and his eyes smiled.
You will doubtless repay it many-fold through your talents.
He gestured to the table.
Please.
Thank you. Anna slipped into the chair across the table from him, trying not to think about repayment. The sorcerer wore blue, as he always did, Anna suspected, but the cloth was more functional, harder than the velvet of the day before. Shirt, tunic, and trousers were all of a faded cotton like that of Anna's green trousers. The circles under Brill's eyes were even more pronounced than the evening before, and the brown-flecked green eyes were themselves bloodshot.
You must have stayed up a while last night, Anna observed.
Something like that.
He sat again and took a sip of the hot beverage in his mug. Anna followed his example, pouring the steaming yellow-green liquid into her mug and taking a small sip. While the warmth was welcome, whatever it wasn't tea, and it wasn't coffee, and it was bitter, with a taste like boiled pine needles. She poured a goblet of water. Before her was another half-melon, and in the middle between them a loaf of bread, some sliced dried apples, some cheese wedges that looked like those she'd rejected the day before, and a jar of reddish preserves. She broke off some of the bread, dabbed some of the preserves on it, and took a bite.
You never did say much about your world, Brill began slowly.
No, Anna admitted, after swallowing a mouthful of the tasty and chewy dark bread. What would you like to know?
Can you create any of the magics like the iron birds?
No, even on my world, Anna said slowly. To create one of them takes a long time and hundreds of special workers. Brill nodded.
I thought as much. What about the magic staffs that throw fire?
Anna frowned. Magic staffs that threw fire?
People put them to their shoulders, and smoke and fire comes from the end, Brill added. Sometimes they kill people from a distance.
There are two parts to that, Anna said. You need to make the gun, and then it needs ammunition, bullets, and that takes a special powder. Gunpowder. Avery probably knew the formula for gunpowder, but she didn't. Anyway, would gunpowder even work on Erde? Slowly, she dabbed more of the berry preserves on another hunk of bread. She was hungry.
You look very doubtful, lady.
Brill set his cup on the table. I don't know enough about Erde to know what might work here and what won't. Anna tried to keep from pursing her lips. It took thousands of people hundreds of years to develop the things you're talking about. She took another mouthful of bread and preserves, then cut a slice of melon. Brill frowned openly.
You make it sound as though magic is very difficult on your world, yet my few glimpses in the mirror waters show many magical devices.
Few? Anna asked, stalling and trying to think of an appropriate answer before she was pushed into admitting something unwise.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.